Okay, I hope you had a good coffee break. Just once forward to my presentation, how I took it, democracy, social equality, and money. It seems a bit as if we have been discussing over and over this issue, so I just want to give my own perspective on it, taking on board some of the comments that have been done previously. Let's start with democracy, demos and kratos. I think it's important to think that we are the constitution of a demos, a community, on which basis and to what extent, and we have already had a lot in that dimension. A community experiences a knowledge access, a constitution highly past dependent. There is a diversity that is even more complex than the one we talk about, huge diversity with some common events. Social equality, a notion that may differ from one country to the other, depending on the path followed to constitute this demos. Diversity of demos that will somehow recoup the diversity of capitalism that was re-acknowledged by economists half a century after the full integration. This specificity of capitalism was surprising for economists because they were all following similar rules, but it's an important figure. After the development of a modern capitalism that had kept some of this historical flavor, distinction on sex, education, wealth may last as shackles of historical specificity. They may last in our conception of social equality. The notion of equality is part of the culture and religion. I have been surprised and told yesterday that the religious issue was not mentioned, moreover. It's part of this notion of equality in every kind of demos. Money, and we have heard a lot of money, an instrument and some point in time of this constitution of the demos. The networking effect of money has been largely stressed, I won't come back. Difficult to quit, to merge, as seen with the experience of the Eurozone, a union which, whatever its advantages in the capitalist world, more and more open to each other, weaken the ties of the demos. I mean, really something hard to swallow in a way. Those who are dealing with this symbol somehow keep a more or less ambiguous status. I mean, the bankers, like the priest in some society, bankers deserve some suspicion. And we had a lot on that dimension in yesterday's show, and it was interesting. Kratos. Kratos is how this government and democracy works. How can the demos govern itself? In countries coming from monarchist system for a lot of them. The basic thing, the thing I want to insist on, that there is a need for a sharp or a pact expressed, and this is a reference to Gary thing, in one language, which is also important. I'm struggling with English, but basically, the sharp I'm referring to is in France somewhere. And it's very important. Money can help in doing so as a symbol of civilization. Social contract or social compromise are somehow part of the constitution, and they have to be taken in an evolutionary perspective. What does that mean? It means that pacts are done at a point in time, things evolve, somehow there can be some erosion at some point with big consequences if this erosion is not acknowledged in due time and revised and led to revision, as we shall see. Kratos designed an evolution. To make a long story short, for many reasons, let us consider modern democratic nation-state, and thanks to Elie, we have gone back to 500 years before. let's consider a modern democratic nation state. Whatever path got them there, with nations following states or reverse, states leading to nations. Democracy can be more or less representative, with representatives in charge in their executive task to act according to the principles, spirit of the charter and social contract. So there is a code of conduct in representative democracy, and it's very important that there is not a big lag between the two. According to that. Or if there is a gap, the important thing is that the system of democracy can leave room to deliberation, amending, reinterpreting the charter according to the changing of context. Representative or deliberative form of democracy, to make it simple, seem a good qualifier of the challenge nation states is right now facing. The post-World War II experience in a nutshell, we are still under somehow the social compromise, or at least we think the social compromise of the post-war era. After the crisis of the 30s, which has already an international, and the drama of the World War II, there was a broad commitment to reform capitalism, to care for full employment and social welfare, or to scrap it, as Kalinsky said, as this system will realize full employment or they will have to be scrapped. Kalinsky is 43. But this is a real stretch at the time because the USSR are presenting an alternative. I tend to insist on the Conference of Philadelphia in May 1944, which made it so clear in this final declaration. For those who don't know, the Philadelphia Conference was in the renewal of the international organization. It was organized by the ILO, who during the war took refuge in Canada, I think, and so. And in Philadelphia, you have to read the declaration because it's so accurate, it's so true. And the story which follows the declaration, which implied, I think it's 44 nations, it's quite big, around the Atlantic mainly, but 44 nations, it's quite clear what needs to be done. And then it is applied in all countries in different form. It's not going to be the same in Italy, Scandinavia, France, even in the US. They are all working on the Employment Act. As a matter of fact, as you all know, and see you, France, it won't be voted. The Employment Act will not exist. But the spirit is there. The legitimacy of the action of representative democracy is somehow rather well pictured in all this story of the late 40s when these employment priorities are set up. Labor is not a commodity, freedom of speech, and all the trade unions agreements. That's how we come to this modern capitalism. The application in terms of full employment is very diverse, and this diversity is lasting, as was discovered. After the golden years of capitalism, relative erosion of the social compromise has been multiplied. Postmodernism, a death certificate postponed for too long. It took too long to say that we were not anymore in these things. In the 1980s, there was for a short while, the idea that consumerism could take over, amend the old compromise. Let's listen to Nader at the time, or to all these new ideas. Let's exchange to the world, we will have more, the consumer power will increase and all that. But this petered out rapidly. Nader is a good example for the US. And finance took over. It was kind of easy for this liberalization. and it took over and imposed a kind of primacy of shareholder value. Then we are far from the basic compromise, and it takes over along with the internationalization of the economy. United in this evolution by the demise of the communist alternative. So we enter an uncharted map of what are the objectives, the goals, the failed goals of capitalism. The long rise of inequality, clearly noticed from the start by our young friend Piketty and Co. I was at CEPMAP at the time, and we had Piketty. I am a regulationist, for those who know that it's a very interesting institution. And we had at the CEPMAP another group very much into the modern orthodox economy. And Piketty and some others came, and this kind of stay aside of this duality that economics is knowing, just to investigate data first, so that you have the long and victorious work, or very clearing the work that they have done on inequality. So these young people saw that the trademark of the pitiful years of capitalism up to the global financial crisis was this rise in inequality. A rise in inequality which put democracies at bay. The gap became so big that the very democratic nature of our nation turned out to be more and more contested. Populist movements were seen as reaction, somehow looking for past solidarity, though not so explicitly. What was clear is the contestation of representative democracy, major slogan calling for dismissal of those who have failed. One has to be careful with the reading of this populist movement. There is also a clear call for more deliberative system. Anyone who wanted to stand for, to be a representative, a representative of democracy, was banned, severely banned, fully banned, no representative whatsoever. Called for referendum on popular initiative. Local action remained few. Positive local action, reorganization of services remained very few and scattered. Even if lasting local solidarity lead to hope that some local initiative will be developed. But little of imagination, very much against and constructing solidarity. All representative and Macron in the first place seem to have learned from the conflict during the big debate. Consensus convention underway in Paris is very interesting with 150 citizens randomly drawn in the case point of this transformation. Macron has a rather anachronic view of our society as a nation where start-uppers could show the way. How it has been updated remains unclear. I'm sorry to have this view, but Macron was
Thanks,
Mariana. I'm very sorry for.
You are welcome, Mike. Blake.
Okay.
No.
Democracy is at day. You catch up with the. I think I was around this, but we accelerate. Okay, the good thing, conference of consensus is on climate change is a measure required. You know what the consensus conference are. It's part of the deliberation. The bad thing is that there is still a strong feeling against public services, where these are major backbone of any social transition, a major topic in the deliberative term to be undertaken. And this is a theme I wanted to put on the table. What do we do with our public services, how they are transformed? Besides the term to more deliberative democracy, to adjust to a world deeply changed by new technologies and internet, has to lead to a new big social compromise. A dialectic between local and global has to take place. That is a challenge to turn towards more deliberative democracies. With a global that is not simply national, but has to be truly linked with a global compromise. Again, taking into account a context where environmental change, internationalization, and technology are de facto global phenomena. That's what we have talked about recently. In that perspective, the SDGs are a blessed framework. Can they be the preliminaries of a global social compromise where every demos will put part of its own historical flavor, much like what happened in the Philadelphia Declaration? That is the question. A chance that it may be the case is that SDGs have the dialectic between local and global built in their status. We look at the SDGs often with the glasses of the past compromise and the mobilization, especially regarding SDGs, directly linked with environmental change, should remount on the basis of local experience. That's the very thing. This is a rough assessment, and a lot of fine-tuning is necessary to see how these 70 goals echo in the various countries concerned. Faced with such diversity, efforts have to be done for some enlarged common reading of these objectives. A set of transformed, renewed international organizations will be needed to help this SDG implementation, as it was the case with the Bretton Woods game. In this work, SDGs want us to go back to some fundamentals regarding our relationship with Mother Earth and with the many leagues, tying communities, making demos, recreating the status of citizens. Basic incomes scheme in this perspective are progressive measures in the transition we are aiming at. So are the development of local complementary models that we didn't address. Market mechanisms have to be strongly domesticated and civilized in order to meet all the requirements that we have to transit rapidly to radically sustainable and fulfilling ways of life. And some food for thought before lunch. You can't see that, but it's interesting. According to region, level of taxation before and after redistribution. When it doesn't move enough, like in Africa, it's meaning that you're really far away from. Sorry, but it will be distributed. You imagine that it is. And I want to go faster. Reconstruct collective action. That's the bashing for the last 3 decades of worker rights, the right to collective action and all that. And to end, the final and 17th slide. Thank you, and the last question. We have 17 SDGs, and I'm proud to say that we have 17 articles in the French Declaration of Human Rights of 1789. I don't know, I did not tell you earlier because one was missing. And it took a century to legitimize the right to a proper salary job, a full employment claim, fully returned in the post-war II era. It took a century for this claim to become a questioning the completeness and architecture of the list of the 70 SDGs may in that sense be crucial as time is fighting a pressing. Thank you and good night.